one of our close partner organizations, Young Chamber Musicians, based in Burlingame out of Coal Mansion, is involved with this initiative as well, because all the pianists and master classes are participants in Young Chamber Musicians this year. So that's also really exciting. So I know most of these young people from their work in their ensembles, and it's a special treat to be able to feature them in their solo piano performances. So today we're going to have two performers, and the whole afternoon is going to be in F minor, so just pace yourselves. It's not going to end well for anyone. But we will have very different pieces in F minor, right? So Beethoven first, and then Chopin. And just a little bit about our performers. Jacob Rockower is 14 years old. We just met Jacob. He's new to Young Chamber Musicians. We're really excited to welcome him. He just spent the summer at Music of Menlo, and I got to hear some of his performances online, which were terrific. He's been a prize winner in many different competitions, and he's going to be starting high school on Thursday. Incidentally, he also just had a big trip, international trip, so we really appreciate him making time from his schedule to be here and share his Beethoven with us. Now, a couple house rules. What this class will not be is any kind of theater at the expense of our young artists. This is for them, and we all get to witness their work. Occasionally, you've probably seen master classes where the master teacher highlights something in a way that is entertaining for the audience, but not really entertaining for the pianist. We have the utmost respect for our young artists, and to that end, we're doing something that I think is a bit unconventional. We have a small honorarium for each of our performers because this is a professional engagement. So in addition to the musical mentorship that we hope to offer, we would also like to set an example for them of what professionalism is and the standards that they can expect for themselves, but also from others. So anytime a young artist gets dressed up, and makes the trip, and shares their gifts, that deserves to be honored accordingly. So we're setting that precedent starting now. We will have complete performances, and then we'll talk for maybe about 40 minutes. And as I said, maybe we'll take a short stretch break between Beethoven and Chopin. They're very intense. So I think that's enough for me. Let's welcome Jacob to the stage, and he will play Beethoven's Appassionata first movement. So F minor is very troubling. I'm going to pull up a chair for a talk, okay? Yeah, Jacob said if it was in C major, it would be a totally different piece. That's right. But there is some C major in this piece, isn't there? Yeah, that's right. That would be crazy. How do you handle all that energy, all that troubled energy as a performer? Because you're performing a very complex high wire act as a pianist as well. Right? It's one thing to have your musical concept of the piece, but then you actually have to deliver to us, as you did so beautifully. What's the balance between all that emotion and then being able to communicate?
I mean, there's, well, for example, like places. Can I play?
Of course.
I can't hold
here. Partly because you Is there any part of you that feels out of control when you play this?
No, there shouldn't be.
Could you try it as if you had a temper tantrum though? And you couldn't actually control it? What would that sound like? Just an experiment. Switch seats. Okay. first time was that you were kind of operating the piano in a way. You were doing it very musically, but it somehow didn't feel integrated into the whole spirit of the piece. If I closed my eyes, maybe I wouldn't have noticed, but I couldn't help but feel that you were kind of managing. This, I felt no managing. And it was just seamless between you and the piano. And that maybe is the main question I'd like to pose to you, not to answer today, but to pose to you. What would happen if you felt that kind of royal ownership of this piece when you played it? Beethoven's really tough for us because he's one of our gods. He's incredibly intimidating. And we learn so much by studying his scores, how to read the score itself. So we learn Beethoven's pieces, but they also become their own kind of pedagogy for us. So much so that sometimes we can feel like they are up on this altar and we can't touch them. But actually, this piece is such a great example. It's contemporary. We still haven't caught up with Beethoven in a lot of ways. The things that he's doing, he's exploded the sonata form in this movement. Right? We could go into any number of details about why that's true, but suffice it to say that the sonata form was never the same after this piece. He exploded the form. The word sonata form was not even really used in writing until later in the 19th century anyway, so Beethoven was not waking up in the morning and saying, oh, it's time to start a new sonata form. You know, that's not how it happened. He was expressing, he was creating new forms or breaking up the old forms to express what he felt he had to say. And my sort of thesis for you with this idea of dramatic conflict is that you have to get in there and take ownership of that conflict. Because without the feeling of inner struggle for us, it happens just a little bit too easily. And I feel funny saying that because I feel like your performance brings so much dynamic power and contrast to it. So it's not like I'm complaining about that. I'm saying, I'm just asking the question, what would happen if you kind of explore that dramatic conflict more internally? And so when you play like that, when you sit in the chair and play like that, I'm going to have you play the game one more time, I'm sorry. I would like this time for you to pretend that you composed this piece. And that you are going to tell us exactly how the story goes. You're not going to try and get it right. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
19th century, and anyone who heard his recitals talked about it like they had seen a tornado. And at some point, early on in Alfred Cortot's life, another great pianist, my teacher studied with Cortot a little bit in Paris, so I have a little bit of a connection to him. Probably when Cortot was about your age, a little bit older, he played this piece for Anton Rubinstein. And Cortot had quite a lot of temperament and pianistic facility, like you do. And Rubinstein listened to him and he said, "Young men never forget what I'm about to tell you. Beethoven's music must not be interpreted. It must be reincarnated." That's what you're doing when you take ownership of that story. By the way, I wasn't following along with the score, but I think you did absolutely everything to achieve it in the score. But it's also like, this is our script. Now, if the script says, Jeff gets up and looks at the lights, if I just do this, that's not very convincing as an actor. But if I have a thought that says, you know, you can kind of get into that and say, oh, something caught his attention. You now have given yourself permission to have the dramatic motivation for everything that you were doing anyway. But, oh my God, what a transformation, you know. Now here's the other thing I want to say. I detest this about master classes. Sometimes these kinds of powerful transformations can occur, and then the teacher goes, wow, isn't that wonderful? Guess what? If you can make that kind of change in 40 minutes, it's got nothing to do with me or anybody else. You were ready to do that. You accepted the invitation. But that's yours, 100%, okay? So from that place, you keep working along the path that you're working in getting to know this piece and digest it. But ultimately, I think that's the most important thing that you can do is to share with the world your, what you say